Good afternoon and welcome to today's thought leader discussion, part of our ongoing anti-racism initiative here at the School of Global Public Health at New York University. My name is Cheryl Healton and I'm proud to serve as Dean here at NYU. Today it is my deep personal pleasure to welcome Dr. Mindy Fullilove to our conversation about the central roles our communities play in the states of our mental health through our life cycle, and importantly, how communities are shaped by the world for the better and for ill, and in turn shape us. Her new book, Main Street, How a City's Heart Connects Us All, is an extraordinary work, and I urge all of you to read it. I have known Professor Fullilove for several decades, starting when we worked together at Columbia University in the mid-80s, when she worked on AIDS and the crack epidemic and led a lab investigating the phenomenon of health and communities and place. I have had enormous respect for her work and read not all, but many of her books. Mindy is a social psychiatrist who explores the ties between environment and mental health. She received her bachelor's degree at Bryn Mawr College and her MS and MD degrees from Columbia University, and completed her residency at New York Hospital Westchester Division in Montefiore, and is a board certified psychiatrist. With her colleagues at the Cities Research Group and the University of Orange, Mindy explores the consequences of social fracture for our society and our health, and seeks ways to reconnect the broken parts. Prior to joining New School full-time in 2016, Mindy taught at Columbia University and was a lecturer at Parsons. She is currently a professor of urban policy and health at the New School. Her new book, Main Street, How a City's Heart Connects Us, is the culmination of 11 years of conducting research in 178 cities and 14 countries. We are so delighted to have you here, and we're going to start with a first question, sort of start at the beginning. Could you please tell us what sparked your interest in writing this book?
Cheryl, thanks so much. It's great to talk to you about this book, and thank you for that, you know, huge endorsement. I really appreciate it. You're an astute reader, and you know a lot about what's going on in America. So, yay. You know, this was one of those things where, you know, I was bogged down in some other work and I went to Starbucks because that's what you do. And I was having a coffee and sitting in the nice sunny window and there were a million people walking by. And I was like, wait, isn't Main Street dead? Why are there a million people? And it was just one of those serendipitous things that said, I better study this because I don't know why they're all here. And I don't know why we say Main Street is dead. It's not dead. So that set me off.
That's great. As you're well aware, the US is deeply divided right now, battling twin epidemics simultaneously, COVID-19, a novel new virus, and systemic racism as old as can be. You've said that the city centers can play a pivotal role in helping us name and solve our problems. Can you expand on that, Mindy?
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the shocks of COVID has been everything being, you know, everybody had a shelter in place, or at least we're supposed to be sheltering in place. And this meant that we're not going to Main Street very much. We're not moving around. And so small businesses and even much larger businesses, retail is taking a big hit. And retail is one of the cornerstones of Main Streets. Among Main Street businesses that are taking a big hit, the minority businesses are just getting wiped out, because they didn't have a whole lot of resources. They've had a much harder time getting whatever aid has been available. So here we have this thing that I think is a major asset of creating the social foundations of health that's just really taking a blow. But one of the, you know, on the plus side, we are all looking around and everybody knows that this is happening. And so we have the opportunity to say, well, don't let Main Street collapse. Let's save it. And so I think that it's interesting, you write a book about Main Street and it comes out just as Main Street is crippled by shelter in place. So, but on the other hand, I think people are gonna pay much more attention to Main Streets than they would have. And, you know, in the spirit of build it back better, we can build Main Streets that are much stronger and do the work that they're supposed to do much better. I think that's an answer to your question.
That's a great answer. And then kind of we're going to drill down on it in some of the next ones. The global pandemic has exposed our lack of investment in communities, weakening our public health infrastructures. This in turn has left our most vulnerable populations to bear the highest burden of disease and death as a result of this virus. I think you were getting at it earlier, and if you think you've answered it, please just say, I'll pass. What are your recommendations to our communities on how to build back better, as President-elect Biden might say?
Well, I have many.
The big ones, the biggies.
Okay.
Maybe.
Well, I mean, but just sticking to sort of the Main Street piece, the people equate Main Street with retail. And so that retail is an important part of Main Street, but it's not the whole thing. So part of the, for me, Main Street building back better is to think, well, what else is there? And how do we think bigger about it? And so there are a couple of things. One is that, you know, we're also in a famine of housing, especially for poor people. So part of the build back better is that I think of Main Street as also what I call the circle, the community that's all around the Main Street. So let's put housing for every part of the population in that circle around our Main Street. So let's build back housing. Second of all, wonderful story today about how we could improve the income of low-income workers by building on their skills. And that can happen on Main Street, and Main Street can benefit from that. So that's my second, is I think this kind of concept of skills enhancement is really fundamental. And then the third thing is, there's a lot of civic infrastructure on Main Streets. Post office is there, libraries are there. And part of what I think is building it back better is to figure out how do we use this civic infrastructure to help more people. For example, in France, the post offices act like banks, and provide many financial services for people. And this would help our post offices and help many poor people who are locked out of banks. As one example, libraries are taking on many functions. Many libraries are on Main Streets. They can be enhanced. So those are my three propositions for building it back better.
Oh, that's terrific. Before we move to questions from our audience and from those who pre-sent their questions, is there a passage or two that you want to read from the book to the group?
Thanks.
We'd love to hear you.
I have the book right here. Next City, which is an urbanism magazine, tackled this question. They said, you know, they wanted to reprint an excerpt. And so they picked this, which I thought was fantastic. And I love the way they laid it out with photos and everything. So you get the spirit of it. And this is from chapter 11, which is called Planning to Stay. So I learned about the concept of planning to stay from Bill Morrish, whose idea it was. But I got to reflect on the life process of planning to stay as a result of a television series. As Mile Orville's Main Street book demonstrates, we can see many of the issues of Main Street taken up in popular culture. Planning to stay came up in the television series, The Good Witch, which is centered on the lives and Main Street businesses of three women, two of them witches. Abigail Pershing, who's the not so good witch, arrives in Middletown, powered by jealousy of her cousin, Cassie Nightingale, the good witch. Gradually, Abigail comes to feel welcomed and secure. While helping to make a wish quilt for her cousin's wedding, she says, I guess what I want most right now is to settle in, meet people who feel the same way about Middleton that I do, people who look at Middleton like it's their home and actually want to stay here. Because of the magical properties of the quilt, her wish comes true. She is invited to join a regular card game and becomes mayor of the town. Sam Radford, the local doctor and her cousin's intended, notes it's weird. Once I decided to embrace being a Middletonian, this happened. He observes, I didn't realize you were just visiting. She replies, I was sort of living my life like that, but now I'm here to stay. I even put an offer on a house, your house. It's a great show. If you don't watch The Good Witch, great show. So Bill and Catherine's insight, Bill Morrish and landscape architect Catherine Brown, who was his wife and partner, were working with old suburbs of Minneapolis. He was tired of the usual urban planning conversation that typically started with listing people's problems. He wanted something different, a new starting point. What, he thought to himself, if we started with the affirmation that we're planning to stay? Then we can ask, what do we need to make that possible? And you'll see if you go to the link in Next City, the sort of whole description of this. Planning to stay became the starting point for community planning. This affirmation of belonging, Bill and Catherine proposed, was the real starting point of taking a sagging suburban city into the future. Having met Bill shortly after I'd published a paper on zero forced displacement in the American city, I experienced this concept as an antidote to the poison of constant root shock. This was the essence of health, affirming commitment to a place. Deborah Tall, author of From Where We Stand, Recovering a Sense of Place, urged us to make a commitment to a known and loved bioregion. That is the only way we can move forward from where we are to a stable future. Bill and Catherine suggested that people look around their cities, taking into account the existing resources in the domains of homes and gardens, community streets, neighborhood niches, anchoring institutions, and public gardens. Through this survey of what they had, people were able to make comprehensive plans for building on their assets and solving their deficits. Main streets were part of the category neighborhood niches. In rich prose, Bill and Catherine described the crucial role of commerce set in the neighborhood and part of its functioning. The neighborhood niche was not only a place to buy goods and services, but also a setting of encounter and pleasure, built to human size and functioning throughout the seasons. These neighborhood niches were critical spaces for connection and community building. In technical terms, neighborhood niches played a role in building weak ties. It was sociologist Mark Granovetter who pointed out the paradox that weak ties are what makes society strong. This was a surprise to me when I first heard it. His argument was that myriad casual connections like those of a storekeeper are connecting ties, while the strong ties of family and religion partition or separate, create partition or separation among groups. While both strong and weak ties are important, it's the weak ties that makes the parts into a whole that is greater than their sum, what we call society. Neighborhood niches build weak ties par excellence. And if you don't mind, Cheryl, because everybody can read the rest of that on Next City, I'd like to skip ahead to a neighborhood niche that you and I know about.
Don't tell me it's Coogan's, I'll cry. I learned that in your book too.
So in chapter 12, I talk about a restaurant. On Wednesday, January 10th, 2018, I read in my morning paper that Coogan's, a restaurant pub in Northern Manhattan, was to close. I had worked for 26 years at the New York State Psychiatric Institute. And during all that time, Coogan's was an anchor of my life. Located on Broadway at West 169th Street, it was a welcoming place and real in the best sense of the word. When I first arrived in Washington Heights in 1990, Coogan's was a unique Main Street spot in a neighborhood that was leading the city in drug-related violence. You remember that, right, Cheryl?
I do.
My offices, several blocks away, were opposite the biggest drug dealer in Washington Heights. And my walk to the office was accompanied by the crunch of little plastic vials in which crack cocaine was sold. Coogan's was part of turning that situation around. It was a place that welcomed the working people of the neighborhood, African-American, Hispanic, and white, people of all ethnic backgrounds, were the hosts, waiters, and bartenders. Coogan's went beyond that, opening its doors for every celebration, joyous or sad, that was going on in the neighborhood. They sponsored a 5K blues, salsa, and shamrock run through the neighborhood, helping reclaim it from violence. So when I read in the New York Times, Coogan's will be closing this spring for the usual horrible reasons, the end of a lease and impossible demands for a new one, I started calling and emailing all my friends. The news was rippling literally through the world. Lin-Manuel Miranda, author of the musical Hamilton, tweeted that the restaurant is one of the, right? Lin-Manuel Miranda tweeted that the restaurant is one of the true Washington Heights main streets, mainstays, and has embraced every wave of neighborhood change. I love Coogan's. My stomach hurts from this news. I signed an online petition from change.org, which quickly garnered 15,000 signatures in 2 days, and learned about a demonstration to be held on Sunday. Emails were flying back and forth when the news broke that the hospital had backed down. Bob Fullilove, who's my ex-husband, got the story from co-owner Dave Hunt. So he was talking to a representative, and the representative said they had to get the highest possible commercial rent. And Dave said, "Are you sure you want to do that?" The representative said, "You may be right, but that's not my department." So they knew the rent was going up, and they knew they'd have to close, but they also knew the Times was doing a story. When they realized it would be posted online on Tuesday, January 9th, they hurriedly called the staff together. So they said, and they had got jobs for everybody. So that night when the Times posted the story, all hell broke loose. Coogan's was getting phone calls from around the world. Dave told Bob, a woman from Columbia was in here, Columbia, the country, was in here and said that her daughter in Kenya had emailed her saying, "What is this I hear about Coogan's closing?" The following night, Wednesday, local political leaders gathered at Coogan's to form a task force. On Friday morning, Congressman Adriano Espaillat and Luis Miranda, Lin-Manuel's father, had a meeting with the CEO of New York Presbyterian Hospital. The congressman called Dave after the meeting and said, "They told me they would revise their thinking and make you an offer you can live with." So 4 o'clock in the afternoon, two guys from the real estate office come over, a very, very simple change to the lease terms with a small rate of rent increase and an annual basis that we could handle. We were able to sign it, and it took 28 minutes. So then Dave said, you know, in that time, he talked about all the people. Bob said, you know, "What is it makes people so passionate?" And Dave said, "Tess, Peter, and I treat everybody who walks in the door like a friend. You're gonna have to work at it not to be welcome here." One of the people that made a beautiful Facebook posting was an African-American bishop, Darren Ferguson, who we have known, well, let's put it this way. We've known Darren since before religious life was on the agenda. I said, I was so impressed and so heartwarmed by the outreach from the African-American community to Coogan's. I hope in the future we'll continue to earn the respect and love of the Black community. He came back at me, "You've already done that." Dave added, "And Mindy was interested in the Spanish people, the Puerto Ricans, and the Dominicans saved the Irish. This is what they did." Dave described going to a local school filled with Hispanic children. He asked them, "How many of you come from, or your loved ones come from, a small island surrounded by water?" They all raised their hands. After a little pause, Dave raised his. "Ireland. They think we're part of the Main Street, that our immigration was a long time ago, but my family came over in the 1920s and 30s. My mother immigrated when she was 16. So that's the story of how the people saved Coogan's. Now, it's been heartbreaking because this very beloved place closed from COVID. They couldn't make it.
Yeah.
But they did a remarkable thing that you may know about, which is that they started a fund on Facebook called the Pay It Forward Fund. And they raised $115,000, and they gave it to 22 other businesses in Washington Heights to help them make it through COVID. So that's a real Main Street story. And it's really that as we think about what Main Street can do, what it does for us, that we want to have that in our mind. It's not simply like you can go there and buy a t-shirt. It's building relationships that get us out of trouble and keep us on our feet.
That's wonderful. So I just want to let those who are on the call who want to submit questions, please feel free to do through Q&A. And I'm just going to move on now to some pre-submitted questions. How does culture influence our way of thinking, and how do people with different cultural backgrounds work together? And this is from Kate Chen, a student in the Public Health Nutrition Program.
It's a huge question. So let's take a piece. How does culture influence us?
The way of thinking, and how do people of different cultural backgrounds work together?
Yeah, well, culture is just a way of thinking, right? It doesn't just influence our way of thinking. It influences everything about us. There's a biologist who says culture is as much a part of our biology as the enamel on our teeth. We don't usually think about it that. We think of it as like some kind of overlay, like I have Black culture overlaid on me. But that would be way too superficial. It's if you think about how do children learn to speak languages, apparently that the way mothers coo at them, so they, you know, like say, oh, I love you, little baby. All those syllables in every language, there are certain ways so that how we hear consonants and vowels is it trains our ear and our brain from infancy. So how we think we're supposed to speak and how we hear is part of culture, right? So it's going into us and making us. So if we're made by our cultures and our cultures are different, then the trick is how do we connect with each other? And that's a kind of a big trick, right? Because we don't necessarily hear the same, we don't look the same, we don't eat the same. I like to do a check-in with one of my classes at the new school. And last week's check-in question was, what's something delicious you ate in the past week? Man, it was so much different food. And I was like a tour of the world just in my classroom. What they thought was good and what they'd had was amazing. So I think that getting along with people with different cultures is very difficult, actually. And it's something that you have to do from an assumption of respect. So I think the real question is, how do you meet everybody with respect? And you really should answer that question, Cheryl, because you meet everybody with respect. And you've been very successful at bringing people of different cultures together throughout your career. You know, one of the great things that you did was the Truth Campaign, right? Where you really investigated what's teen culture and how do we speak to teen culture with ads against cigarettes. And, you know, you found some breakthrough ways of conceptualizing that. That's how we do it. So however you did that, that's the real answer. So there you go.
Well, thank you.
What Cheryl does.
Very kind of you to say that. I had an army of ad agencies working on that with us. So that's very kind of you to say. We have another question from Samara Mabugu. I'm sure I crucified that name. I apologize. An NYU alum with Global Health. Which present day city would you have added to your research that isn't already included and why? What was the city that got away?
You know, at this point, I'm trapped in my house. I would go to any city.
I can relate.
I would go to any city. Okay. 178 cities was enough.
Well, okay. All righty. Phyllis Ekos from NYU alum at law. How does your research potentially connect with the scholarship of Jane Jacobs' Re-Neighborhoods with efforts to preserve streetscapes?
So I'm very influenced by Jane Jacobs, and one of the great moments of my life was when she wrote a blurb for the paperback version of my book, Root Shock. And it was just shortly before her death. I was just so moved by that. Jane Jacobs is not simply about the preservation of streetscapes. Because a lot of streetscapes she thought were really bad, should be redone. So she was about making cities dynamic places and understanding what made it dynamic. So when she talks about things like short blocks, so all of Washington, D.C., I know you spent a lot of time in Washington, D.C., Cheryl, they took down all the regular buildings and they put up buildings that could fill a whole block and ruin the whole thing. So it's kind of dreadful. It's all the charm and the coziness that used to exist has been bulldozed away and replaced by these big blocks. She was very much against that. So if she were walking around Washington, D.C., she would be thinking how to change that. How are you going to give it some life back? So she was really for that dynamism. How do you put in dynamism in a way that respects people? So I think her thinking is fundamental to my own. I've always had the experience that you could take Death and Life of Great American Cities and open to any page and learn something fantastic. Amazing book.
Yeah, that's very true. Let me see what we've got here in the Q&A. What do you think might be the long-term implications of COVID-19 on our ability to join together and solve community problems?
Well, I mean, I don't think COVID-19 is going to kill us all, but we're handling it as badly as you could handle anything.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
And so if you were going to infer something about our ability to handle community problems from how we're managing COVID-19, I think we would get an F.
Yeah.
You know, if in South Korea, 500 people have died, and that's not a small country. If 500 people can die in South Korea from COVID, and we have, you know, we're moving on to 300,000.
It's insane.
It's a catastrophe, our management. And I preach constantly about epidemic management to my network. And they're still always coming up with ideas that are like, no, you can't do that. It's not good. So, and I would say my network is very enlightened, but it's because there's so much confusion in the messaging and we don't come together. So think about the next big problem that we have to deal with, which is climate change. What are the odds we're going to get it together? Really bad. On the other hand, the point you made earlier, Cheryl, which is that we've come to see inequalities in a new way. But the conversation around how we're going to distribute the COVID vaccine, especially in the early stages, is hugely enlightened. So we are seeing in what bad shape we are and what needs to be corrected in ways I don't think we ever have before. But we are in terrible shape. The constant dividing of our country has left us very polarized and angry and violent. Think of how many times somebody's mad at somebody, the right wing is mad at somebody, and the person gets death threats for like pretty simple things, like I'm in charge of the election and I counted the ballots and your guy didn't win. It was like, oh yeah, well, we're gonna kill you. It's quite, for me as a social psychiatrist, it's not a surprise, but it is very, 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 very serious. We're barely on life support.
Yeah. I'm with you. After the murder of George Floyd, we saw a number of communities come together to bring awareness to the centuries-old problem of racial injustice. Given what you found while writing this book, can you recommend some steps on how we can unite to make additional progress?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of asset-based community development as a way forward. And I would say that we very much work with, when we're working on cities, there are two processes. One is called sorting out the city, which is moving people around and compartmentalizing them by race and class. We're constantly moving people around. And the reason to move people around is so developers can build new buildings. But every time we move people, we compartmentalize it more. So that's bad. But it's really this replacement urbanism, right? So those two things go hand in hand. And so, and cities are like, oh, we don't have a good tax base, so we better get some wealthy people. Meaning, let's get rid of these poor people that we have and get some wealthy people. That's just part of the disaster. So the opposite is planning to stay. Let's plan to stay. And if you're going to plan to stay, you got to say, what have we got? And then what do we need? And then, but not, we need some wealthy people, but what do we want to do with what we have to be in a better position? So that's what we have to do, I think. That, I think, is the way forward. It's a reorientation, what we call restoration urbanism, as opposed to replacement urbanism, and sorting out the city, which is a major source of all this hatred.
That's great. We have two more questions so far in the chat, and people are encouraged to add more if they're interested. Are there potentials for farmers markets beyond selling food?
Why not? So one of my long-term colleagues is Rod Wallace, and he works a lot with his wife, Deb Wallace. They're ecologists, and they're geniuses. And they had a son. It turns out their son is also a genius, and his name is Rob Wallace. And he recently published a book called Dead Epidemiologists, which is about the origins of COVID-19. And he's some kind of biologist, but the title is so long, I can't say it. You have to look at his work and he will tell you what he does. But it has something to do with where does a germ come from? And one of his conclusions is that one of the big sources of out of control, all these new pandemics that are coming down the pike at us, is agribusiness. Yes. And so one of the solutions, both for climate change and these out of control new pandemics, is to get rid of agribusiness, which means family farms, which means how do they sell? So farmers markets bring us into contact with farmers and help us know where our food comes from and how. So I think they're incredibly important. And then if we're going to tackle agribusiness, I think they're going to be very, very important. So while you might be thinking farmers markets might sell handmade quilts, what I'm thinking is farmers markets can help us undo agribusiness.
It's all revolution.
There you go.
Okay. And now from your friend, Anna Bredalanza, thank you for your remarks, Mindy. Your work is so important. Could you say a little more about the role of Main Street in helping communities overcome various disasters? Did you see differences in types of disasters, natural versus other types, such as economic?
Hi, Anna. Well, certainly the economic disasters were all around, because I started this in 2008, so we were in that big recession. But then there are also some natural disasters. Of course, there's no such thing as a natural disaster. And so, you know, the floods in Ellicott City, Tropical Storm Irene, Hurricane Sandy, were all stories that I got to follow over the 11 years of this project. One thing about disasters, I mean, each disaster is unique. What does it take out? It's going to be different. But there are no fully remediated disasters in the United States. And they're especially not fully remediated if you're low income or minority. And you know, because we do have this replacement urbanism as a model, it's always like, how can we get rid of poor people or get rid of something and bring in something that create a better tax base? There's a lot of drive towards that. So I would say that all the disasters push us, whether so-called natural or economic, push us in that direction, that they become a tool of this regressive urbanism that we're in the clutches of. And so just people suffer and they have ongoing suffering. And it's very hard, very, very hard. So how is Main Street help? So the Main Streets, in my view, are like the nervous system. They're like nodes in a nervous system. And the streets are the connectors. And so if you were to go into your brain and knock out a whole bunch of nodes, you would have senile dementia or Alzheimer's. And so sort of imagine our country, we've knocked out a lot of the nodes and we're a dysfunctional country. So how dysfunctional are we? South Korea has 500 deaths from COVID and we have almost 300,000 and rising. That's how dysfunctional we are. So we can repair this nervous system of ours, this social nervous system. And that's the function of it, to keep us connected, keep us aware of each other, keep us in exchange with one another, keep us respecting each other. think, you know, there's a terrible thing that happens in McCarthyism that people don't talk about too much. So McCarthyism is the attack on people because they're communists, the Red Scare. But at the time, they also start to build public housing in a manner that's really ugly. They didn't have such ugly public housing in the 1930s and 40s. And there's no reason for public housing to be ugly. I have interrogated many architects on this question. It doesn't have to be ugly. But we made it ugly at that time. And I think it's because public housing was for poor and working people. So they wanted to undermine the power of working people to have any good ideas. Like, oh, socialism is a bad idea. Look at people who live in public housing is the sort of unspoken association. So we're still struggling out from under that. And as long as you say most of the population doesn't have any good ideas and they're not going to be respected, how are you going to have a healthy nation? So that's the big problem.
Very astute observation. From Ashley Amuka, welcome to you, Dr. Fullilove. How do you get different aspects of cities, transportation, businesses, community centers, housing, et cetera, to work together to solve urban problems from your social psychiatric lens?
Thanks for the welcome. And that's a nice way to start a question by being welcoming. And it is part of the answer, right? Is people gotta be a little bit welcoming of each other. And it relates to what I was just saying about just putting down whole sections of the people. What if you turn that around? And what if you have respect? I had a quite remarkable experience last week. I was moderating a panel for the National Association of County Transportation Authorities. And so four people on the panel who were the heads of their county transportation organization. And one woman said that during COVID, quite to her surprise, because she was kind of a by the book manager, she had to learn how to bring emotions into the conversation. And both the Black guys who were on the panel said that they were finally able to get issues of racial equity into the conversation. So sometimes it takes a crisis of this magnitude for people to say, oh, the way we're doing it is wrong. And so we have to use such crises to make the kind of shift to cooperation that's inherent in your question. That's what we have to do. And that means that we have to have a sense of what we would like to see. What my father talked about is you have to know what you're for. You have to know where you're going. Stephen Covey, right? Start with the end in mind. We want to make a shift. What's the shift? Okay, we like to have people talking to each other. We have to know that now so that when we go into crisis, we say, okay, now's the time, let's cooperate. And we pull people together. If we had cooperation, who would we convene? Cheryl, you're one of the greatest conveners I know. So I don't know if you want to add anything about convening, but you've done some great convening.
Well, I can say that convening in the age of COVID is much harder. I think that's actually unfortunate that we're dealing with a problem where the ways of convening that we're accustomed to are cut off from us at a moment when, as you point out, we're going through the arc of history will define what happened here, but this will be one for the books forever. Yeah. One for the books forever, that so many people died in such a short period of time with such inequalities baked into it and such stark differences across different countries. So it's a real, I don't know what is the word for it, a classic study in an unmitigated disaster that will, I think, require a soul searching exercise of decades and decades. So I do think the tools in the book, Know What You're For, because I don't think most Americans are for what's happening, but they've been blinded to the reality of what's actually happening. But I do not think that will persist. it will be, you know, as often happens with things like this, everybody will know somebody. And as time goes on, they'll know many, and then they'll realize it just sinks in, unfortunately, when it's too late. But I don't want to be too negative, but it's pretty negative. You have another wonderful question, and it's a biggie, one you and I love. What is the role of universities in supporting communities in which they are located?
Whoa. Yeah, Cheryl, no question. We're all about that.
You don't knock the Audubon Ballroom down with a wrecking ball. Let's start there.
Let's start there. Keeping the facade, right?
Yeah, that's better than plan A.
You know, it's an interesting question because, you know, so an Audubon Ballroom, they kept the facade, or at least a little piece of the facade of the Audubon Ballroom. My offices were located on 166th Street. And so they put up another building, and the back of the building, so the back of the building was facing the community. And the whole back of the building is this blank white wall. I always thought of it as a big white butt facing the community. Yeah. But they're both just sort of like, how do you connect to community? You don't be fake, right? Don't just leave the facade and don't put up a blank white wall. So part of how universities deal with communities is by, well, universities have two faces, right? They have their corporate face and they have their life of the mind face, for lack of a better term. Or even in the case of schools of public health, a positive face, like how can we help? But those are in direct contradiction to each other. And so part of the struggle of universities is that if their corporate role is to destroy communities, that's gonna be the horse pulling the cart. And then public health is gonna be running after trying to clean up, but you'll never be able to catch up. But there comes a point at which people have to recognize that it's one ecosystem, we live in it all together, and if you destroy it, we are all destroyed together. So I think that's the question before corporations of all sizes, including universities as corporate actors, is, do you want to wipe out millions of species, including our own, or you want to have a future? You know, people have to put some brakes on themselves.
Okay, well, I agree with that. Those who have early entry on the property ladder of a city tend to have an asymmetric privilege compared to latecomers through ability to pocket a large piece of their renter's wages. Is that system fair and just? If no, how do we cure it from the rent-seeking virus? How do we cure it from the rent-seeking virus?
I wouldn't, just because of my own research and experience, put it exactly that way. It's more than just arriving early. A lot of people have arrived early. They're what happens next? And you know, people say, well, it's been a popular thing for people to say, well, Black people need to own a home, as if Black people didn't know they needed to own a home. But a lot of Black people owned a home and then it was taken from them. So urban renewal is, a major story. Redlining is a major story. Planned shrinkage is a major story. Taking the necessary infrastructure out of poor neighborhoods so that they fall apart is a major part of this story. So it's not just when you arrive and bought a home, it's all these other things. And so we're really talking about concentration of wealth in the hands of a few. I don't think anybody's come up with a better term for it than David Harvey. Accumulation by dispossession. So if I can get rid of you and take your land, I'm richer. So how do we stop accumulation by dispossession? And I think that's part of this issue of people have to decide, do we want to survive or do we want to be rich? I think we only get to go in one of those directions.
You might, just in answering that question, you might, because of the age range of the audience, you might want to just describe in a few sentences redlining and redevelopment and condemnation, and because of course not everyone here has yet had the opportunity to read your book, just to give a little context, educative context.
Even old people don't always know.
Okay.
So after the American Civil War, there's millions of slaves who've been freed, and there's a big national debate about what's going to happen next. And basically part of the debate is, let's establish the freed people, so let's give them education, political power, and some land. That's one side of the debate. The other side of the debate is basically the Southern oligarchy wanting back all the power they had under slavery and pushing the freed people back into a new status of second-class citizen. So denying them the vote, denying them education, and denying them land. That side gradually wins, and they institute segregation. So by the 1890s, the laws start to accumulate for segregation, and the nation becomes segregated. So when the Depression hits in the 1930s, the federal government sets up a program to aid bankers by saying to them which neighborhoods are good for investment and which neighborhoods are bad. This leads to a survey of American cities and to a set of maps. These are the infamous redlining maps that stratify cities into four. It's a 2x2, famous 2x2 table, white, non-white, new, old. And basically, non-white and old buildings are red, don't invest there. New buildings for wealthy white people are green, invest there. And basically, investment still follows that paradigm. So redlining is a very important part of this story. The parts of the city that aren't invested in deteriorate. So then they come up with another brilliant plan called urban renewal. And that's a plan to clear land using eminent domain, which is the power of the government to seize somebody's house, clear the land and sell it to a developer for a higher purpose. A higher purpose could be a school, like a lot of universities got land in under urban renewal. Or it could be a cultural center. Lincoln Center was built on urban renewal land. And that was a huge national project carried out in 2,500 American cities. 2,500 projects in 993 American cities. So then other similar policies like planned shrinkage follow on the heels of that. So there are a long series of policies that lead to upheaval and that dispossess poor and people of color and take their land and give it to other people. Our paper, Serial Forced Displacement, which you can find on my Ruchok website, has a much longer list and more detail.
The next question is, how can we turn around the pattern of disinvestment in our inner city neighborhoods that has ravaged and weakened us?
So if we think about the redlining paradigm, which says don't invest where there are poor people in old buildings, unless it's going to be for new buildings for white people, whatever white is, if we're operating under that paradigm, we'll never get investment wherever there are poor people and people of color. So part of it is we have to understand that paradigm and we have to get rid of that paradigm. But part of that is that we also have to understand that this is capitalism and this is how capitalism deals with the land. Land is a very important source of wealth and power, and we're not trying to share the land. The capitalists are trying to own all of it and leave the edges to the other people. And it's not so clear that they want to even leave edges to the other people. They don't care. A headline in the Times today was that the Trump administration refused to tighten pollution yes. rules, even though it's shown that pollution aggravates COVID and causes people to die.
So, I mean, that in and of itself, on some level, dare I say, says it all. So are there any further questions that anyone would like to pop into the chat? If not, I think I see one that just popped in, maybe not, but I think so, yes. Can you comment on the politics or economics of gentrification? Are there examples of communities that have successfully dealt with gentrification?
The second
maybe
part.
Anywhere.
What?
I'm adding maybe anywhere. You can maybe start in the US, but is there anybody who's been, I think,
anywhere.
Positive.
The whole world. You know, I mean, the answer is no. And so, you know, the dynamics of gentrification are complex, but it's really about what I'm calling replacement urbanism, which is you have some land and there's poor people on it and they're not worth much for taxes, gradables. So cities want to get rid of them. And they don't care about what happens to the poor people, where they're going to go. They just don't want them on, like, I don't want them in my city because I need more rateable. So I'll get some wealthier people. So I'll get rid of these other people, get some wealthier people, and everything will be fine. That's crudely the dynamic that's going on. We're watching it now in Orange, New Jersey, which is my hometown. And many communities have fought this and fought it successfully for periods of time. But the people with money they know what they're for. And they just stick to their game plan. And gradually, the community organizations fall apart for one reason or another. The great leaders get old and die. And they're able to take the land. So there are a few stellar, amazing stories, like the story of Cooper Square, which is in the Lower East Side. Where a committee just fought and fought and fought and won. But those are very rare. And if you expand the time frame, no, we're not winning. So far, the capitalists are winning. So we're in a serious situation.
So let me see if we have any more questions. No, I think to follow up on the last two questions, how do we go about reinvestment in divested communities while countering the reality of gentrification? There we go. We're a group of people in search of some optimism here.
Well, I just want to switch a little bit because I know a lot of these people haven't read the book, and you didn't start off by saying, wow, this was a really depressing book. And so I just want to say that Main Streets will make you feel better. These are tough questions, and we're in the grip of something that's larger than ourselves. It's a system, an economic system, that's about the concentration of wealth. And that has inherent in it the creation of poverty. Poverty is not an accident. Poverty is part of capitalism. And that it wants to concentrate the wealth, all forms of wealth, including the land, ownership of the land. That this is a system, we are in it, and it's driving what happens. But it's driving it, but it's not the only thing. So there is a horse and there is a cart. So when you go to Main Street, you see things. You see somebody decided to have a mural. You see somebody decided to have a taco truck. Somebody decided to just walk down the street talking to themselves. Somebody decided to have a really cool outfit. So a lot of my experience of working on this book was going to Main Streets in 178 cities in 14 countries and just having a blast, you know, going to have lunch somewhere, hanging out in a park, seeing strange and wonderful things. So this gives us inspiration. So under the current rules of the game, we're not winning, but the game is more complicated than what we're thinking of. And so we have to go figure out what else have we got that we can use.
And part of why Main Streets are so important is that they lift our spirits. They make us feel energized, make us feel optimistic.
Well, I agree with that. And just one final question, if we don't have another one that pops in here. I know that you've advised leaders of other countries. I know you've advised the mayor of Paris at times in your career. Tell us a little bit about the pattern of the things we've been talking about now and how they play out in other cities in the world, whether it's Europe, South Africa, places that are not countries like European countries or South Africa. In other words, what differences do we see, if any at all? And just thinking from a global perspective about Main Street, which of course your book is very global.
Yeah. Well, what do I think? I think that in some other countries, there's just a much bigger conversation, and more groups of people are listening to more groups of people. And so in the US press, for example, when we talk about France, we tend to represent their problems as the same as ours. Like, oh, they beat up a Black man. But their problems aren't the same as ours. Their problems are the same as theirs. And then we don't have their problems, they don't have our problems. This is different. For example, France was a colonial power in ways that the US wasn't quite. Even when people talk about European colonialism coming to the US, that shifts with the American Revolution, right? It's just complicated. So the histories are different, the people who are involved are different. And so you see things and you hear things that are kind of surprising. Every city that I've been to in France, and I've been to quite a few, you know, I'd go talk to the urban planners, and they would be saying, well, we have $50 million to improve our transit. Every city you go to had money coming in to improve how it was functioning. And where have you been to in the US where a mayor of a major city said, oh, I've got $50 million to improve my transit, right? Wouldn't these transit authorities all over the US that are in such crisis like to have them? So I think there was much more positive urban conversation, much more inclusive conversation, always, always derailed by past histories of racism and colonialism and capitalism, but quite different from ours and with possibilities that maybe we don't have. That was my experience.
Well, that's great. Well, we have come to the end of our time here. And I want to thank you, Mindy, because it's just been absolutely terrific to have you here today. And I want everyone, even though it will be virtual, to join me in a round of applause for terrific, terrific opportunity to speak with you and have a dialogue with you. And to the audiences, thank you for joining us. And I wish everybody a wonderful, safe, and modified in COVID ways holiday season. So thank you all for being here. And Mindy, especially, most of all, thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. It's been wonderful.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.